So we were in scene 21, the last scene. So we just saw that the king appreciates Iyer and allows him to speak in the manner that he is used to. And the king tells Cornwall, one of the nobles who accompanies him, "Ha ha, say Cornwall, didst thou ever see his like?" And the nobleman says, "Not I, my lord." So this appreciation of Simon Iyer as a person who is very...
Sir, we can't see you.
Who is very jovial and very frank in his speech. The characters are mostly taken by Dekker from Delaunay's story, Thomas Delaunay. And the boisterous nature and behavior of Simon Iyer that we find in this play, that is Dekker's original introduction, original creation. We may say that he made Simon Iyer a figure who would be much more dramatic and would be able to generate a lot of laughter, and therefore he would be the best leader of all these shoemakers, who are all represented as fun-loving, merry persons. Then Lincoln and Whately arrive. So here there will be a twist in the plot. Earlier we saw that the king pardoned Lacy, and therefore it appeared as if the danger is over and Lacy and Rose can marry in peace. But here is a twist when Lincoln and Whately arrive. Lincoln complains to the king, "My gracious lord, have care unto yourself, for there are traitors here." So he says, "My king, be careful, because here we have traitors." So by traitor, he is referring to his nephew, Roland Lacy. Now, in England, treason was the highest crime, and the greatest punishment in law was reserved for treason. Therefore, charging somebody with treason would be a very serious matter. So from this we can assume how angry Lincoln was with nephew, and this anger is generated out of Lincoln's rejection of inter-class marriage. So the purpose here in displaying such hostile reaction by Lincoln is to affirm, is to establish that inter-class marriage was taken very seriously, and there would be serious opposition against it in society in Elizabethan England. But at the same time, such marriages were taking place, which means that society was moving forward, becoming more and more progressive. The feudal, the feudal noblemen, they were losing their authority and power. Therefore, the middle class, they were moving up in the hierarchy of power and wealth. And thus, social mobility, class mobility could be seen. This drama of asserting the values of one class as opposed to that of another, this is a social drama, which drama could have tragic endings, comic endings. Here, Dekker is dramatizing this social conflict in a comedy, and therefore with a comic ending. But this drama had all the potential of ending tragically as well. So this very serious charge of treachery or treason is brought against Lacy by none other than his own uncle, only because Lacy wanted to marry a girl who hails from the middle class, and otherwise she is fair, good-looking, and a girl to be appreciated. And therefore, Lincoln has this great class prejudice. And we will later see that allowing Lacey to marry Rose and forcing Lincoln and Otley to accept this marriage, the king proves to be more progressive than many of his nobles. So it may be Dacre's way of suggesting that the English king is a progressive king and thus displaying his own patriotic fervor by showing the king in a favorable light, in a good light. So here, as Lincoln says, there are traitors here. Everybody says, traitors? Where? Who? Traitors in my house? God forbid. Where be my officers? So Ayer is also very perturbed. I will spend my soul ere my king feel harm. So the traitor must be trying to harm the king. So I will rather give up my life before my king can be harmed. Thus we see here a kind of patriotic notion or patriotic sentiment in Simon reflected here. And the drama suddenly turns very serious with this accusation being brought in by Lincoln. The king says, "Where is the traitor, Lincoln?" Indicating Lacey, "Here he stands." And immediately the king understands why Lincoln calls him a traitor. And Lincoln doesn't even know that the king has already pardoned him. So, but for the moment, the king pretends to be acting on Lincoln's instigation and says, "Cornwall, lay hold on Lacey." That is, arrest Lacey. "Lincoln, speak. What canst thou lay unto thy nephew's charge?" So you have to read out the charge. Whenever anybody is arrested, the charge against the accused has to be read out. So you tell us, what is your charge against your nephew? "This, my dear liege, your grace to do me honor, heaped on the head of this degenerous boy desertless favors. You made choice of him to be commander over powers in France, but he..." So Lincoln says that, "To do me honor, to bestow me with honor, you had given a lot of responsibilities on this boy." Degenerous means degenerate. So degenerate means he has gone down, he has fallen. So this degenerate boy, you have favored him with lot of serious responsibilities, and you made him the commander of choice or selected armies in France. Powers in France means armies in France. But he, and then as he is going to continue, the king stops him. "Good Lincoln, prithee pause a while. Even in thine eyes I read what thou wouldst speak." So by looking at your eyes I can know what you are going to say. "I know how Lacey did neglect our love, ran himself deeply in the highest degree into vile treason." So just to satisfy Otley, the king says that Lacey committed vile treason. Even though he does not believe it, the king pretends to believe in Lincoln's words and says, "Yes, he neglected my duty and he committed vile treason." And Lincoln is happy. "Is he not a traitor?" "Lincoln, he was. Now we have pardoned him." So if he has got a pardon, then he is no longer a traitor. "It was not a base want of true valor's fire that held him out of France, but love's desire." The king says that he did not follow or did not obey my command, not because he lacked in valor or that he was afraid of going to war, but because of his love's desire. So his love compelled him to act otherwise. "Lincoln, I will not bear his shame upon my back." "Then you cannot hold me responsible for his actions. If you have pardoned him, I will not be ashamed, or I will not take any shame or partake or share the shame because of Lacy's actions. Nor shalt thou, Lincoln, I forgive you both. So you need not be ashamed, because I forgive both Lacy and you. So both of you have no charges against you. Then, good my liege, forbid the boy to wed one whose mean birth will much disgrace his bed. So the final appeal by Lincoln to the king, that if you have pardoned him, then you ensure that he does not marry a girl. Marrying her will bring a disgrace upon his bed. So please ensure that he does not marry such a girl. Are they not married? The king says in a mock surprise, in a tone of mock surprise. Lincoln says, no, my liege, because Lincoln was not present during their marriage, and to him the marriage was a hearsay and not very acceptable in the absence of relatives, guardians. So it was a kind of a clandestine marriage. Therefore he says, no, my liege, but both Lacy and Rose together say, we are. So the king says, shall I divorce them then? Oh, be it far that any hand on earth should dare untie the sacred knot knit by God's majesty. I am not sure whether it is a criticism of Henry VIII who went for a divorce. But here we see this point of view, conservative point of view, the Roman Catholic point of view, that there should be no divorce, because marriages, as they say, are made in heaven. Marriages are by blessings of God. So the king says, how can I divorce them if they are married? And the sacred knot of marriage, how can I untie it, because it is sanctioned by God's majesty? I would not for my crown disjoin their hands that are conjoined in holy nuptial bands. So marriage was considered holy. So the tie that was, the knot that was tied according to the holy rites of marriage, I cannot untie that. Lacy. Then the king asks Lacy, how sayest thou, Lacy, wouldst thou lose thy rose? So it is all kind of drama by the king. The king is pretending that he is fairly judging these people, so that Lincoln or Otley, they are not much aggrieved. Lacy, not for all India's wealth, my sovereign. So he says that I am not ready to lose my rose. I love her so much. So even if I am given all India's wealth. So in this expression, you see an affirmation that India was proverbially considered to be a very wealthy country. In all Renaissance literature, we find a reference to India. Not only Renaissance, in the Middle Ages also. India was considered to be a land of proverbial riches. And
we find it in Donne's poem.
And from a post-colonial point of view, when we look at Renaissance literature, these expressions, they confirm the you know, point of view that England was becoming proverbially rich. England was also becoming very rich through colonial exploitation, and the reason of colonizing India was nothing other than its wealth. The king, but Rose, I am sure, her Lacy would forego. Rose would forego her Lacy. So the king kind of prompts Rose, you know, to deny that she was agreeable to divorce. And since the king does not ask Rose directly, so Rose says, if Rose were asked that question, she would say no. King, hear, you hear them, Lincoln? Yeah, my liege, I do. Yet canst thou find in the heart to part these two? Who seeks besides you to divorce these lovers? So the king says, even if you hear that they cannot part with each other, yet you have the heart to want them to separate. And then That is, the king suggests that Lincoln is behaving in a cruel manner and selfish manner. And then he asks that whether anybody else wants a divorce of these two people. So that is a tradition, whether in marriage or in divorce, to ask publicly whether anybody is against that marriage or anybody is for that divorce. And when the king asks that, then Otley says, "I do, my gracious lord, I am her father." Now that the king asks it, Otley finds an opportunity to express his view and says, "As Rose's father, I object to this marriage." "Sir Roger Otley, our last mayor, I think, the same, my liege, would you offend love's laws?" So the king says that love has its own laws. So, would you go against love? "Well, you shall have your wills. You sue to me to prohibit the match." The king says that you and Lincoln, you will have your will. That is what you want. So you file a petition. You make a plea for annulling this marriage. And then he says, "Soft, let me see. You both are married, Lacy, art thou not? I am dread sovereign. Then upon thy life I charge thee not to call this woman wife." So the king offers immediate justice to Lincoln and Otley's suit and says, "Well, you both are married, Lacy, you are also married, and then I forbid you to call Rose your wife." So Lacy is quite surprised. And everybody is surprised, and Otley says, "I thank your grace," but Rose pitifully begs the king, "Oh my most gracious lord," she kneels down and begs the king not to annul the marriage. And here is a, you know, a humorous moment, because the king is doing this only to temporarily satisfy Lincoln and Otley. He is not serious about it at all. But when Rose is pleading, a young woman, so the king jokes with her, says, "Nay, Rose, never woo me," as if Rose was quoting him. "I tell you true, although as yet I am a bachelor, yet I believe I shall not marry you. So why are you pleading to me? I am not going to marry you. So do not quote me." So it is clearly humorously said, "Rose, can you divide the body from the soul yet make the body live?" Rose is still very serious and very unhappy and says that "I and Lacy, we are like body and soul. So if you take soul away, then can the body live? That is, I will not be able to live without Lacy." King, "Yeah, so profound. I cannot, Rose, but you must divide." So this is a profound point of view, philosophical point of view, that you have expressed a philosophical question whether the body can live without the soul. But I cannot answer that, but I cannot let you be together as well. You must divide, that is, you must separate. "Fair maid, this bridegroom cannot be your bride. Are you pleased, Lincoln? Otley, are you pleased?" So he tells Rose, "This bridegroom cannot be your husband." In the Elizabethan period, bridegroom and bride, they could be interchangeably used. So bride can also mean bridegroom. Both Lincoln and Otley say, "Yes, my lord." So they are happy that the king agreed to their proposal and accepted their plea and has annulled the marriage of Roland and Rose. "Then must my heart be eased." So now that you are happy, my heart is eased. "For credit me, my conscience lives in pain, till these whom I divorce be joined again." So even though my heart is at ease because you are happy, but my conscience is not, because I have separated two lovers. So until they are joined again, I will not be fully satisfied. "Lacy, give me thy hand. Rose, lend me thine. be what you would be, kiss now, so that is fine. At night, lovers to bed, now let me see, which of you all mislikes this harmony? So he takes the two hands of Rose and Lacey and joins them and says that now you have all the permission to be husband and wife, and you can even live together at night in bed, and then let me see if anybody has any objection to this harmonious marriage. Of course, he was sure that nobody would dare to question his authority. Otley, will you then, Otley says, will you then take me from my child perforce? So you are giving my child away to somebody which I did not want. Will you do that by force? Why, tell me, Otley, shines not Lacey's name as bright in the world's eye as the gay beams of any citizen? So Otley is a citizen, that is a middle class person. And does not Lacey's name shine because he is a noble man? But at least his prestige should be as good as that of a citizen. So there should be no reason why Otley should object to Lacey, who is of noble birth. Lincoln says, but my gracious lord, I do mislike the match far more than he. Her blood is too base. He says that my objection to the marriage is even greater than that of Otley, because I object to my nephew being married to a girl whose origin is very low, very base, because she comes from the middle class. So in this, Lincoln demonstrates his snobbery as being an aristocrat, and Otley also demonstrates his class consciousness, and he does not want to marry his daughter to a person from a higher class. Now, in general, in marriages, people prefer the husband and wife, or the bride and groom, being from a similar background. If they are not from similar background, then they might have a conflict, or they might have difficulty in accepting each other. And that is why for marriage, at least for arranged marriages, people always look for husband and wife, bride and bridegroom from similar backgrounds. Therefore, the king does not allow Lincoln to speak further, because he does not accept this snobbish aristocratic attitude and point of view, which displays class hatred, that is not mere indifference, but Lincoln shows a hatred towards the middle class. Lincoln no more. Dost thou not know that love respects no blood, cares not for difference of birth or state? The maid is young, well-born, fair, virtuous, a worthy bride for any gentleman. Besides, your nephew for her sake did stoop to bear necessity, and as I hear, forgetting honors and all courtly pleasures, to gain her love, became a shoemaker. So Lincoln, you should not be so prejudiced, and you should know that in the matter of love, class, concerns of class, origin, birth, these are not important. And besides, your nephew is born a gentleman, he is fair and virtuous, and therefore, the girl Rose, she is well born, fair, virtuous, and worthy to be the wife of any gentleman. And your nephew, on the other hand, stooped lower than his birth, because for the sake of his love, he became a shoemaker. So he stooped, he went down in the social hierarchy by becoming a shoemaker, and therefore you should not have this attitude that your nephew is much higher in rank. As for the honor which he lost in France, thus I redeem it. Lacy, kneel thee down. So now the king has a master stroke. He makes Lacy a knight, and thereby Lacy becomes very honorable, and nobody can object now to his marriage. So Lacy kneels and king taps him on the shoulder with his sword. So that is the ritual of making somebody a knight. Arise, Sir Roland Lacy, tell me in earnest, hotly canst thou chide seeing thy rose lady and a bride? So the king addresses Lacy now as Sir, because he has become knighted. He has become a knight. So Sir Roland Lacy, and he tells Otley that can you now object that your daughter is not only a bride but also a lady, because marrying a knight, she would also have the rank of nobility.
Your sound is not clear.
My sound is not clear. I think it is okay. So Rose also has the position of a noble lady because she married a knight. Otley, I am content with what your grace hath done. So now Otley accepts this. And I, my liege, since there is no remedy. So Lincoln finds that there is no way that this marriage can be prevented. So Lincoln says that I have to accept it since there is no remedy, because the king is so serious about this that he even makes Lacy a knight, which means that Rose also becomes a noble lady, and therefore there is no benefit or no profit from opposing this marriage where both of them are made noble by the king. Come on then, all shake hands, I will have you friends. Where there is much love, all discord ends. What says my mad Lord Mayor to all this love? So now he asks Simon, what do you have to say this? Everything is ending here happily because of this love. So love appears to be a power which harmonizes everything, and everything ends happily. O my liege, this honor you have done to my fine journeyman here, Roland Lacy, and all this here we find that prose and verse are mixed. Roland Lacy, and all these favors which you have shown to me this day in my poor house will make Simon I live longer by one dozen of warm summers more than he should. So I appreciate the king's gesture and says that you have honored my journeyman, Roland Lacy, and you have shown me favor, and therefore I will live a dozen of years longer. I will live another 12 years because of this favor. Nay, my mad Lord Mayor, that shall be thy name. If any grace of mine can length thy life, one honor more I will do thee. The king says that it is not because of me that everything has ended happily. That shall be thy name, means that you are also responsible for bringing things to a happy end, because you intervened, you persuaded me on their behalf. So you must get some reward. One honor more I will do thee, that new building which at thy cost in Cornhill is erected shall take a name from us. So Simon Eyer had built a new building at Cornhill, which the king says, I will give a name to that building. We will have it called the Leaden Hall, because in digging it you found the lead that covereth the same. So historically Simon Eyer had built a building which was named Leaden Hall. And it was a familiar landmark in London in Dekker's time. So the king gives the name to this building. I thank your majesty. And then Lincoln, the king speaks to Lincoln. And as he wants to speak to Lincoln, Hodge, Firth, Ralph and other shoemakers enter. So a great number of shoemakers, they come. Ayer, how now, my mad knaves? Peace, speak softly, yonder is the king. Because their sudden entry might disturb the king, so he says, speak softly, the king is here. With the old troop who is there, we keep in pay, we will incorporate a new supply. The king tells Lincoln about the military strategy, that the old troops, the army which is already stationed in France, apart from that, we will add more forces, a new supply. Before one summer more pass over my head, France shall repent England was injured. I will teach France a lesson within a year, that is before another summer arrives. So the reference to these, you know, international issues and the issue of war suggests that all this marriage, love affair, all these romantic plots, they all take place in the context, historical context, when France, England is at war with France. And with the arrival of the king in this play, this addition to the play, the addition of the character of king to the play, lends it a superior scope, we may say, or value, because now the context becomes wider. So it is not just a question of individual plots of romantic affairs, but also the international issue of France being at war with England. And then he asked, what are all those, when the shoemakers arrive? All shoemakers, my liege, sometimes my fellows, in their companies I lived as merry as an emperor. So when I was with the shoemakers, they were my colleagues, then I lived very happily among them. My mad lord mayor, are all these shoemakers? All shoemakers, my liege, all gentlemen of the gentle craft, true Trojans, courageous cordwainers, they all kneel to the shrine of holy Saint Hugh. So Ayer says that they all worship Saint Hugh, they are all authentic, genuine shoemakers, and they are all courageous people. So then King says, mad Simon, would they anything with us? So why did they arrive? Do they want something from me? The king is using royal plural, and royal characters speak in plural. So what do they have with us means that what would they want from me? I had to shoemakers. Mum, mad knaves, not a word. I will do it. So Ayer says that now I am your representative. I will speak to the king. You shoemakers, you all keep quiet because you won't know how to speak to a king. Then he kneels to the king and speaks in a very officious manner, just to display that Ayer can also speak formally. They are all beggars, my liege, all for themselves, and I for them all on both my knees do entreat that for the honor of poor Simon Ayer and the good of his brethren, these mad knaves, your grace would vouchsafe some privilege to my new laden hall, that it may be lawful for us to buy and sell leather there 2 days a week. So he asks permission from the king to use laden hall, the building, 2 days a week for transactions in leather. So why is this important here? Why should it be at all mentioned here? Because this play, whereas it is about love and marriage, much of it also is about trade and commerce. And this building which Simon Ayer has built with his own money, how that would be used, for that he asks the permission from the king, because now it is a public building and the king will decide how it would be used. And the king says, mad Sim, I grant your suit. You shall have patent to hold 2 market days in Leyden Hall, Mondays and Fridays, those shall be the times. Will this content you? So he allows the shoemakers to use the Leyden Hall for 2 days a week for their transactions, for their business. Jesus bless your grace. Then Ayar says, in the name of these my poor brethren shoemakers, I most humbly thank your grace. But before I rise, seeing you are in the giving vein and we in the begging, grant Sim Ayar one boon more. So he says that I still have something to ask from you. And I thank you for what you have already given. But since I am in a begging vein and you are in the mood of giving away, so let me ask something else. What is it, my Lord Mayor? Vouchsafe to taste of a poor banquet that stands sweetly waiting for your sweet presence. Please accept our invitation and, you know, participate in this banquet. You eat with us. So that is the prayer that Simon makes to the king, and he wants the king to share the meal with them, which would be a great prestige for all of them. And the king very graciously accepts this offer. I shall undo the ire only with feasts, meaning that by eating at your cost, I will turn you a bankrupt. So the king is joking. Already have I been too troublesome, say, have I not? So we see that the king is very, you know, sweetly disposed to Ayar, and he takes a liking for Mad Simon Ayar, which will also impress the audience, and the audience will also love this character. And several veins of politics, economics, commerce, social relationship, marriage, all these come together in the plot of this play. And the ending of the play is also thus a harmonious resolution of several different things, also the military. So the king also decides about what to do with the war in France. The social mobility is demonstrated by making Lacy a knight, and then by virtue of marrying him, Rose becomes a noble lady. So we have not only the you know, promotion of Simon Ayar from a shoemaker to a mayor, but also we see other characters also, they also rise in rank and nobility. And even though in the midst of this background of trade and commerce, the latent threat of becoming bankrupt or going to the Ludgate prison, which we had in the earlier part of the play, that threat never materializes, but we see the other side or the opposite side, that characters become nobler, wealthier, and they become better than what they were at the beginning of the play. And Lincoln and Otley, they are also forced to, you know, forego their prejudice or to abandon their prejudice. They are forced by the king to accept this marriage. And thus this marriage ennobles all the characters in several ways, because it is a progressive action. So Ayar says, oh my dear king, again here we have mixture of prose and verse from lines 174 and 183, there are verses, but before that there is prose. So prose mixed with verse. Oh my dear king, Sim Ayar was taken unaware upon a day of shroving, which I promised long ago to the prentices of London. Shroving means merrymaking. So here Ayar explains why he feasted the apprentices of London, why he offered them a banquet. He says that long ago I had promised to the apprentices of London about a day of merrymaking. For and it pleased your highness, when I was prentice, I bear the water tankard, and my coat sits not a whit the worse upon my back. That is, when many years back I was an apprentice, then like all apprentices I used to carry the water tanker on my shoulder, and for that my coat sits well on my back, which means that that did not demean me in any way. And I have, on the other hand, succeeded and finally became the mayor of London. So long back, many years back, I was an ordinary apprentice, and then I used to carry the water tanker on my shoulder. As it was Shrove Tuesday, and then upon a morning some mad boys, it was Shrove Tuesday even as it is now, gave me my breakfast, and I swore then by the stopple of my tankard, if ever I came to be the Lord Mayor of London, I would feast all the apprentices. So some apprentices on a Shrove Tuesday gave me breakfast, meaning that he did not have any money to buy his breakfast. And the apprentices gave him breakfast, and on that day he promised that someday he will feast all the apprentices of London. Someday he will treat all of them. This day, my liege, I did it, and the slaves had 100 tables 5 times covered. So today I fulfilled this promise, and the 100 tables were covered 5 times, which means that 500 people ate, or 500 apprentices ate. They are gone home and vanished. Yet add more honor to the gentle trade, taste of Ayer's banquet, Simon's happy mate. So they have gone home after eating, and now if you also participate in this banquet, then I will be honored much more. And the king says, Ayer, I will taste of thy banquet and will say, I have not met more pleasure on a day. He happily and very generously agrees to share a meal with him, and says that it had been a very pleasant day. Friends of the gentle craft, thanks to you all. Thanks, my kind Lady Mayoress, for our cheer. So he, because the king is very polite, so he thanks everybody and thanks the mayor's wife, Marjorie also. Come, lords, a while let us revel at home. When all our sports and banquetings are done, wars must right wrongs which Frenchmen have begun. So the play ends with the theme of this war. The theme of the war runs concurrently with the theme of the mad Simon Ayer becoming the mayor, and the marriage plot of Lacy and Rose. So the king says that now let us revel at home, let us relax, let us enjoy, and when our sports and banqueting are over, then we will take up serious matters in hand, state matters, and we will decide how we will treat the French a lesson and right the wrongs that the French men they inflicted upon us.